morning. And thank you for being here. I apologize for the slightly delayed start. We still have people on the way, but we'll get started. So thank you so much for being here. And we are very pleased to bring to you the second edition of the Pocket CIO to Bangalore. This year, we've already done the Pocket CIO programs in Delhi and Mumbai. And lots of your colleagues and friends and other people you know have attended them. So this is the final chapter of the Pocket CIO for this year. And some of you, of course, have attended our program last year. And I'm very pleased to welcome you all back again this year. For people who are coming here for the first time to the Pocket CIO, let me just take 2 quick minutes to explain what this program is about. So the Pocket CIO was started as an initiative to help the IT manager community get acquainted with some of the issues, challenges, and problems that CIOs typically face in their day-to-day program. It is to prepare people like you to take up both technology as well as leadership strategy challenges. And which is why the program, as it's organized over the next 2 days, the day one, which is today, has a series of technology sessions. So all the people who would be presenting these sessions are, you know, highly experienced, knowledgeable people who will be talking about the subject, and they'll be talking about the latest trends in those particular areas and how these might have an impact on what you're doing in the enterprise. Tomorrow on day two, we are having the more management oriented sessions. These are being conducted by in areas such as IT strategy, leadership, you know, innovation, you know, operations, so those kind of areas. And the people who will be taking these sessions are also highly experienced and have number of years working with the senior IT community and, you know, guiding them on, you know, doing these things. So please, all of you, you know, I would encourage you to attend all these sessions and to take benefit out of them. The benefit comes not only because there's a more lecture being delivered, but also this is an opportunity to ask questions, you know, clarify some of the things, you know, ask things you think are relevant. There are no right questions, wrong answers. There's no such thing. This is, we would like this to be slightly more participative because that is how it will be helpful. You know, a question that one person may ask may also benefit 4 other people. Of course, the sessions are very tight. We have a large number of sessions, so this is going to be a busy day for all of you. And as many of you know, at the end of every session, there is a test. The purpose of the test is not only, it's not just to test knowledge, but the tests are designed in such a way that, you know, it captures not just what is being talked about in the lecture, but around the general subject area itself. So take the test just in the right spirit. The idea is, you know, that it just helps you to know for yourself how much you know or you don't know, and that's an opportunity for improvement as well. Of course, when you are doing a lot of hard work giving these tests, so, you know, there are some good things after tests. So we have these certificates. So for people who attend all the sessions for both days, you have a participation certificate. If you do well in the tests, you know, so you get the minimum pass marks, you actually get the Pocket CIO certificate. And for people who do extraordinarily well, you get a distinction certificate. So there are those distinction certificates. And each of our sponsors who are taking the sessions have sponsored a special certificate for the person who scores the highest in a particular module. So those special certificates are also there. So there's lots of certificates to be, you can walk away with. So I encourage you all to, you know, pay close attention to what is being said. And please take the test in the right spirit. Just to let you know that, is it possible to get a distinction certificate? Yes, we did give them out in Mumbai, but not in Delhi. So there is a person who's got a distinction certificate as well. Okay. So with that, I'd like to call on stage our first speaker for today. He's Mr. Nitin Bhandari, Associate Vice President for New Products and Partnerships with Vodafone. And Nitin is responsible for the development of new products for the enterprise business at Vodafone. And his current focus includes machine-to-machine services, cloud, mobility, and hosted product ecosystems. Nitin is a well-known speaker. He's widely quoted in industry publications. And he's a co-author of a service model framework, which is published by the Telemanagement Forum. And prior to Vodafone, Nitin was with Frog Design, where he was responsible for managing the innovation strategy practice. And earlier, he's worked as a consulting partner with Wipro in the business advisory practice for telecom and media. So Nitin has a degree in computer science and engineering from the Institute of Technology, BHU. And today he'll be talking about building an organization for the future. May I request you all to please welcome Mr. Nitin Bhandari to the stage.
Hi, good morning. Am I audible to everybody? I guess, great. So, in the last few years, we have seen that the always on communicable gadgets as well as cloud-based applications have pretty much changed the way businesses behave, businesses feel, businesses work, and so on. So what I wanted to cover today was some recent trends and innovations that the IT community here could leverage in order to foster innovation in your respective organizations and in order to kind of start owning up the role of a CIO. So before we move to where we are today, let's just travel back in history about 13 years. How was the world like in 2000? So in 2000, if one looks at it, just 1 second, the animation did not work. There's a PDF. I think you have PPT also for this. There's a PDF version. Do you have PPT version for this one?
No, we have
PDF. Okay, forget it. Can you just do it? Because there were some animations here. That's okay. Okay, so you will not be able to see the animation, but it's fine. So back in the world of, back in 2000, CIO, the definition of CIO was he will own the IT assets and other parts of organization. And in this case, this is a real example from one of our Cola customers, where the warehouses or the inventory will be owned by the procurement organization. The delivery of these Cola bottles onto the shops and vending machines will be owned by the COO organization, whereas the so-called customer experience was pretty much owned by the CMO. And if you were to do a fast forward to 2013, what has changed? So if we now look at it, CIO is pretty much responsible for not just owning the IT assets, not just owning the so-called IT, rather he is now pretty much responsible for the measurable business impact. One of the reasons why this has happened is IT and communication now touches almost every aspect of a business. So in this case, if you look at it, there's a vending machine, and if the vending machine runs out of cola, there's a sensor which detects it. The machine-based M2M sensor will send the information automatically to the warehouse, where the inventory will be checked, a truck roll is done, and the best route is formed. Once the cola bottle is filled into the vending machine, the sensor will again confirm that the vending machine has it or not. So it's no longer based on trust, it's no longer based on best use basis. So CIO is pretty much responsible for measurable business impact. And now let's look at three mega trends which we believe will shape up the future phase of business, which will shape up pretty much the way we work at businesses and the way our businesses deal with their customers, deal with stakeholders and employees. So this is the first one, and the first one, as you look at it, it's about now. The future is not really about mobile. The future is pretty much mobility. And what do I mean when I say this? So if you go to the early days of internet, it was pretty easy for a company to put their presence on the or put a website on the internet. Okay. But it was equally difficult for the companies to kind of create a consistent dialogue with their customers. So not every company which created a website was able to convert it into a profitable means of conducting a dialogue with the customer and so on. The same story pretty much got replayed in the era of social networks. Okay. So almost every company, every business has got a face on Facebook or Twitter. Okay, but then not every company has been successful in converting that into a profitable channel. So same way, mobile is like, you know, nuts and bolts. Mobile is like a channel. Now, how you convert that channel into a profitable means for yourself is where the mobility comes in. So mobility provides you the context. Mobility helps you convert mobile into profitable business channels, okay? So be it using supply chain management application, be it using new ways of transferring money, be it using new ways of payment. So call it an overall customer experience, call it an overall way of reducing the cost, improving the efficiency of your operations, improving the reaction time between the foot soldiers and the headquarters and the boardroom and so on. So what we are already seeing is now, mobile is pretty much becoming almost everywhere, and it is a mobility that will determine whether the businesses in the new era are successful or not. Same way, internet and social era determine the success or failure of a number of companies. Even if you look at the stats, last year tablets grew by about 49.5%, and by 2015, one in three of every computer shipped will be tablet, and this is pretty much true. Number of smartphones have already exceeded the number of PCs being shipped. In a country like India and many other countries, there are more people accessing internet using their mobile devices vis-a-vis the fixed line devices. Okay, not only that, the number of applications which are now being created for tablets and smartphones have started to pick pace with the ones which are being created for PC, and by 2015, these applications will outnumber the PC-based application 4:1. The second phenomena that we are witnessing is the way computing is evolving. Okay, so in a way, if you look at it, the computing is becoming smaller and smaller, but at the same time, the volumes are increasing. So computers are everywhere. Computers are pretty much dissolving into the environment. And what I mean by that is almost around us. So earlier, a computing resource meant a PC, a large PC. Now, you know, around us, be it in our watches, okay, the smart watches are here, be it our mobile phones, cars, even small things such as thermometers, thermostats, are pretty much computing devices. So in our generation, we kind of so far saw two phenomena which changed the face of humanity. The first was Internet of Systems, or Internet as we know it. The second was Internet of People, again, likes of Facebooks and Twitters. The third phenomena, which will pretty much change the face of humanity forever, is going to be Internet of Things, or machine to machine, as it is also called. What it will do is, so far, our interaction with computing resources was hands and eyes. And IoT is going to bring in sensors. IoT will kind of use non-visible things, so, you know, be it sensors, be it our hand movement, the movement on the road and so on. So this is going to bring a phenomenal change, and the interaction between a human being and the interaction between a back-end application will no longer be restricted to eyes and hands. It's going to be much more than that. And that's where this opens up a kind of completely new set of opportunities for businesses. Okay, so it opens up new opportunities for businesses to get into your customer life cycle, to get into your consumer life cycle, be it through as simple example as controlling the washing machine remotely. So that's a simple one, but then there are a number of other applications which are already finding the way into things such as healthcare. We have now remote controlled devices which can help human beings take the medicines, which can help in a lot of stuff. And last year, there were the three most talked about innovations in the world of M2M. One was connected cars, and almost every car now contains much more code than the first set of mainframes which arrived in this world. But the other two ones which are most talked about was Nest. Nest is a thermostat which helps you capture activity, light, temperature reading, and so on remotely, and then take certain actions which you can pretty much take which you can pretty much convey through your smartphone. Okay, and the sensor could be located in your house or in your office, could be miles away. The second most talked about innovation was this IBG glucometer, very much an application that resides on an iPhone. But then there is a small device which you see, which can fit into the iPhone, and it helps you take blood glucose readings and a number of other things. Automatically transmits it to your doctor's clinic or hospital, where number of algorithms can act on it, and then it can advise you on certain medication, increasing the dose, decreasing the dose, and so on, rather than just going by the gut feel. Again, if I look at the statistics, by 2020, there will be more than 30 billion devices connected to the internet. Okay, that's many more times than the number of human beings on this planet. So a big opportunity for businesses to kind of go and capture the market, to get into your customer life cycle, and be closer to customers all the time, not just when he calls you, when you call him. The third one is about the data flow. Okay, while there's been a lot of talk about big data, but then if you look at it, what is happening, there's a lot of data which is available today. The key thing in making success out of data is how fast can you take a decision. Okay, so you have got your foot soldiers on the ground, meeting your customers, with your customers, and so on. And then you have got headquarters who are supposed to take the decisions. And what's happening is, you know, the thin line between success and failure is how fast can you convey your decisions to your sales force, to your field force. Again, if I look at the stats, the digital universe is going to be about 44 times bigger in 2020 than it was what it was in 2009. And most of this data will not flow from within your organization. Most of this data will flow from outside your organization, and you are supposed to act and react on it pretty quickly. So it's not just the case of data coming from one source or from your organization, whether it's truly a case of data coming in from multiple sources, how it's interwoven, and how fast can you take decisions. So if I look at it, yes, these three technologies are pretty much driving the way, are pretty much driving the behaviors, and hence they are pretty much driving the business innovation. A big question is now, who is best suited to lead the change? Any guesses who is best suited to lead the change that these technology innovation are bringing in? Okay, any more questions? More answers? Yeah, so you are right, yourselves. Okay, it's not really us. Actually, it's not a question of us and somebody else. It's a question of more and more of these changes are being driven by technology. So the opportunity is there for the larger IT CIO organization and so on. Now it's up to them on how they utilize it, how they leverage on it. There's a survey which was done earlier this year by Gartner, and this is pretty much a global survey. And the key point here is a similar survey was, okay, because the animations have gone, I think, they don't see the animation there. But a similar survey was done about 5 years ago. And each of the CIOs were asked, if they were to set a priority for their CIO and IT teams, what is the priority that they will set? About 5 years ago when they did it, the priority one was improving IT application infrastructure. Okay. Now if I look at what is the priority one is actually not really about IT. Priority one is not really about assets. Priority one is not really about cost here. If I look at what is the priority one for them is, the priority one set by CEOs for their CIOs is improving the revenue. Finding new ways and means to increase the revenue, and the second one is deliver the efficiency. So it's, if I look at it, the top two is not really about cost anymore, top two is not really about IT estate anymore. And then it's about reducing the cost and attracting and retaining customers. So that is where the adoption of new technology, and not just the adoption, but translation of new technologies into what it may mean for business is possibly going to be the key in key in moving up the ladder and becoming the change agent across the C-suite. So yes, I mean, there's a unique opportunity to be the harbinger of change. And now that the next thing is, how do you create the impact? And I'll talk about a few statistics and give about 4 or 5 case studies on, and they are the real world case studies on how some of our customers have made an impact to their larger businesses and organizations. So yes, you could pretty much create a desirable impact by ensuring that there is better operational agility, happy connected employees, and improved customer engagement. But the key thing here is the central one, which is connected employees and the happy and connected employees. Okay? Because if the employees aren't happy, it's going to be very difficult for them to make their customers happy. Same goes with all of us. If we aren't happy, we can't really make our customers or our bosses happy. And yes, the operational agility. So let's get into more. So what does operational agility mean? It means competitiveness. It means that if you and your peer, your competition, your peers have got the same resources, there's going to be one who will be more successful than others. And that will pretty much be determined by who is more operationally agile. These surveys were done by FRC Research globally, and 53% of the businesses believe that the ability to scale and converse is vital to their success. And at the same time, they also believe that workforce flexibility can increase the performance by 20%. Okay. So if I look at it, 53% and 20%, yes, we are really talking, I mean, in today's economic scenario, if we could add our growth by 20%, that definitely means a lot. That's, you know, more than a couple of years of growth over for any business. The second one is about happy customers. Happy customers, they actually get you repetitive business, and the cost of repetitive business is always lower than the cost of first time business. So 70% of customers, if we look at it, and all of us do happen to be customers ourselves, we expect responses in less than 2 hours. So while we may not expect a resolution in few hours, we do expect our responses in less than 2 hours, and this is a global survey. And at the same time, 59% of businesses believe that technology innovation propel better customer experience. So customer experience is not just being delivered by customer services, by the CS organization, but by innovation, and at the same time, how fast you are responding. And the speed of response is pretty much determined, like what we saw earlier, is pretty much determined by how fast can you move the data around, how fast can you take the decisions, and so on. The third is about flexible workforce, which obviously increases productivity. And I guess almost everybody here during the course of the day is going to refer to their respective iPads, tablets, smartphones, and respond to the emails. And that's the best example of how flexibility is helping our respective businesses. And the world of business has always been about the best people, but if you make them flexible, if you make them give them the right tools, that not only improves their work-life balance, that also improves the productivity. So I'll go through a few case studies, real-world case studies on how we have helped organizations deliver on these three pillars. So the first one is about connected employees, a story from India. This is a story from India from an automobile manufacturer. And this company, they wanted to provide, so they were, until about 8 months ago, until about, yeah, about now a year ago, they used to kind of allow only a single type of device. More and more of the employees weren't happy because they were forced to take on a particular device, and that's when they said, fine, we'll allow flexible device options. Now the next question was, while we allow the flexible device option, how do we ensure that the proprietary data is secured? How do we ensure that if the employee leaves the organization tomorrow, he's not taking my valuable contacts and other resources with him, and so on? So what we provided was a mobile device manager, also known as Vodafone Secure Device Manager, as a brand name, which kind of helped them pretty much control the company data, divide the device, the logical partitioning of device between personal space and work space, just like a company IT administrator can pretty much control your laptops and PCs. Same way, we allowed their IT administrator to control their mobile devices. And at the same time, we left the use of personal space to individuals, to individuals, and they could do anything, but whatever they want, whatever pictures they wanted to click in the personal space. But when it comes to the work, the official space on the device, it was pretty much controlled by the company administrator. So much so that if the employee was to leave without notice and run away, remotely the data could be wiped off from their workspace while his personal space remains with him. Then what we also provide was locking of certain device features. Now, this was a manufacturing organization. Their processes as well as plants are pretty much, they're copyright, they're IP. And typically in a number of these places, nobody's allowed to click a photograph. And earlier, they could do it by restricting the use of camera. Now today, every mobile phone has a camera. So you can't really say, you know, keep the mobile phone at the security desk before you walk in. But at the same time, we would want to protect the proprietary information. So what we provided was, basis the location, you know, if you happen to be in inside this manufacturing plant, you will not be allowed to click a picture. So the device itself will not allow you to click a picture, but if you are outside the plant, yes, you are in your personal space, so you can go and click pictures and save them and do whatever you want to do there. And a number of things. So this was not just helping employees feel happy, this was also saving money for the company, because earlier when they had mandated the devices had to be supplied by the company. The typical cost was about 20,000 rupees. In this case, for the saving and the typical life cycle of a device, such a device is about 3 years. So saving, average saving for 1,000 employee business over 3 years, it comes to about 20 million rupees, which you can obviously partly return to your employees or give them, let's say, 50% discount if they were to go and buy their own device. So it makes business sense for you, and it also makes your employee feel happy. Good for both. Let me give the second example, which is about location-based services. Okay, a cola company, even if I don't name them, they are here from their logo, and there was no way we could have removed the logos from here. So by the nature of the business, they had a number of, they had thousands and thousands of vans and millions of retail shops. Now, how do you ensure that the highest efficiency of the delivery? How do you ensure that the driver who is responsible for this truck does not take a detour and start watching a movie for 3 hours on the way, or does not take a detour goes to his home for a longish lunch, extending few hours and so on. So what we brought in was a location based. Technology which effectively allowed the organization to track their vehicles, to track the workforce, got this one integrated to their internal portals, to the management dashboards and so on, so that each of these trucks could be assigned a geographical area, each of these trucks could be assigned a route, and if they find out that these drivers were kind of going away from the assigned routes, or let's say 500 meters away from the assigned route, there is a light which blinks, and somebody in the organization knows that this truck is not following the route that was given to him. Okay. Now, this could be used for safety purpose, this could be used for improving the efficiency and so on, that's left to the organization. But what this company figured out was, just because the drivers now knew that they are being tracked, the efficiency start to go up. So, because when you know, yes, somebody is tracking you and so on, the efficiencies automatically went up. And this is something which definitely helped them also improve their channel experience, because the retailers started to get the deliveries on time. And the retailers found that their refrigerators were then always filled with the stock rather than the empty ones. Now, this is the third story about M-Pesa, about cash collection. Now, this is something which has not been launched in Karnataka and the Southern India now. At this moment, we have been launching this in phases. We have pretty much covered the Eastern India and the Northern India, now being launched in West India and then in South. But over next 6 months, we would have the whole of the country covered. Now, what this allows is to convert your physical cash into electronic cash. And once it is an electronic cash, yes, it could be moved around pretty fast. Now, this is a story from UP, from a microfinance company. Now, as it happens with the microfinance company, then it's a similar story with, even if you are an FMCG company, you have got your service agent who go and service, let's say, these washing machines and refrigerators, scores of them every day, and by end of the day, they're actually carrying a lot of cash. So there's this microfinance company where they used to send agents into villages and into hinterlands to collect a small value of cash. But by the end of the day, he would have collected scores of those small value transactions. So it actually becomes large. Okay. Now, that's when there's a risk. When he's traveling back from a village to the city, he could always be robbed. And there have been cases which have come to light. At the same time, this agent, if he does not go and deposit full money into the branch, nobody really knows whether the money was really collected or not. He can always go and deposit only 50% money and say that the other guys did not give him the cash, and then he can run the cash through his own cycle and make money out of that interest. Okay. So what we did here was, if you look at the number of bank branches in India, there are about 100,000, number of ATMs are about 125,000. Number of Vodafone retail outlets are about 1.5 million plus. So now in the rest of the country, as we are scaling, as we have started to roll it out, we have already started leveraging on our agency network, where after collecting, let's say, 4 or 5 parcels of cash, this guy goes to a Vodafone phone shop, hands over the cash, moves it into electronic money, and it transfers the electronic money into the branch, and then the branch can transfer it into headquarters, and so on. But because this is electronic money, this starts to show on the dashboards immediately. HQ knows how much money has come in today, and they can start rotating this cash. So when it was physical cash, their rotation time was minimum of a week before the HQ gets to know that the money has been collected and can be repumped into the business. Now they actually know it instantaneously, and this helps them with the cash flow, and this pretty much helps them in making more money out of money. Similarly, I mean, there are other examples where we are using M-Pesa to pay salaries to employees who don't have bank accounts, construction laborers and so on. Salaries to employees who are operating in areas where, you know, you don't have banking network. Most of the villages still don't have banking network. Even the number of post office branches in India is only 1.25 lakh. Okay, so not every village is covered by these. And it becomes, it's pretty costly for a company to then start arrange cash, send cash in vans with 2-3 bodyguards around it and so on, and then start and then go and disperse some money. So we have started to use it with a number of construction companies, microfinance companies, and so on. So I'll talk about now this another example. This is about customer experience, pretty much from this city, where we ran a pilot to provide Wi-Fi services on the metro network, okay, using a combination of our fixed line MPLS network and 3G, and at the along with the user authentication and session management, where we give full control to metro effectively, so that while people are traveling in the metro, they could actually avail the use of Wi-Fi services. Another example from Cisco, where we kind of leveraged our global presence, so the Vodafone and K-Band Wireless combined presence. We are now there in almost every country put together. And we help Cisco improve efficiency of their networks, reduce the vendor footprint, because they had a single vendor to deal with, they had a single communications partner to deal with, and so on. And hence, improve the productivity of their communication infrastructure. So, if I look at these, and there are many, many more examples that we can talk about offline during the break, we could definitely help you build a competitive edge and create and create an impact. Okay, so it's all about bringing employees, stakeholders, and customers together. Okay, and then enthuse the operational agility piece in it, and that is what we believe creates the winners and the formula for success. So if there are any questions, I'm happy to take them. Yeah. Can we have a mic go around if there is one?
Hi. You actually said about paying to people where the banks are less, the post offices are less, and not through cash by putting security of people. So what's the solution there? You only touched upon it. Can you please elaborate a bit more?
Sure. So, wherever they are, there are at least 10 or 15 shops, you'll find a Vodafone outlet. Okay. So what happens is you have electronic cash, which is like pretty much stored electronically, which could be, so not on your mobile phone actually, electronically in a central location, which you can access through your mobile phone. So think of it like this, it's just a reverse of prepaid top up. Okay. So when you go for prepaid top up, you actually pay him cash, and then this guy electronically tops up your phone account. This is just a reverse. You now have a phone account, which is separated, which we call a mobile wallet, separate to your prepaid account. Now, when you go to the Vodafone shop there, you actually you deduct your electronic money, and this guy will pay you in cash. And then there's a charge around it, which is actually lesser than what a post office or a bank will charge you. So originally, this was meant for the migrant laborers. Okay, so especially the migrant corridor, the laborer corridor from the eastern India, Bihar, West Bengal, a number of them come to the western part and the northern part of India. For them, either they use the non-banking channels to send money back home, where security is an issue and the cost is very high, and they seldom use banking channels because neither do they have bank accounts nor their family have bank accounts. So this was originally developed for them, where they could do the money transfer, but the same thing has now been adopted for the larger enterprises and so on, because once you convert the money into electronic cash, you could move them around fast. Now, maybe the next question is, why cannot bank do it? So all our retail shops and all, they're already connected to our network. So we have already made that investment because by virtue of selling mobile services. So for us, the incremental cost of doing this was pretty low. But if a bank has to set this up, their transition cost will be very, very high. Because one, they, like I said, they only have 100,000 outlets, and in fact, the number of corresponding banking agents in the country is also about 125,000 only. So they are nowhere; they are at least 10 times lower than our network already. So, and then they will have to put in this infrastructure. So their incremental cost is going to be much, much higher.
Right. Sure.
Sure.
Nathan. Yeah, you mentioned about the mobility. And when you're, suppose the data, say you're maintaining the data and all things through the, for the benefit of the organization. And when it comes to security, what is the pain points, what all the pain points they are taking it, and how the data has been protected? Suppose for employee leaves an organization.
Sure.
And see, you have mentioned about the logical data and the personal data. And how the logical data, the company's data gets protected. As an IT administrator, they can able to protect the information. But can you elaborate on this more?
Sure. So what we, so this solution is known as mobile device management, an application equivalent is actually loaded onto your mobile. Now, the application is then controlled not by the user of the mobile, rather by the admin of the company. Okay. So the employee has to give, obviously give in writing that he is happy, you know, he's willing to get his device controlled by the administrator and so on. And then in the workspace, so in the so it like after the logical partitioning in the workspace, if there are contacts, phone numbers and contact book, if it is there, then and if there are photographs stored and so on, and if the employee was to leave, while the employee leaves, unlike in laptops, the mobile phone, for him to use the mobile phone, he's always connected. So think of it as a VPN. So he's actually connected. So he's actually connected to the company administrator. So unlike a laptop where for an administrator to control the laptop, my laptop has to be on the LAN or VPN of the organization. So I can always do, I can always leave and then ensure that I copy all the data before I put it on the LAN or before I return. But here, by default, it is on the air. So it is connected to the administrator. So the administrator could run policies. Think of it. So this concept is pretty much similar to how BES server operate, the BlackBerry BES server. But then while BlackBerry had BES, non-BlackBerry devices did not have any equivalent of BES. So this is something which brings all kind of devices on par, be it iOS or Android or even BlackBerry. So remotely policies can be run, and remotely, you know, those policies can do harm or good with your devices.
Yeah, you.
So if you could have the Nitin, mic go around.
Here. Oh, yeah. Yeah, just a wonderful presentation. When I saw about a couple of major things, you said about increased revenue and deliver efficiency, right? Where most of the case studies what you have presented here, goes back to delivering efficiency. Some thoughts or some case studies that where you have really increased the revenue of the company other than the product engineering, right? Where the CIO plays a role of IT, so where the product engineering, increases revenue. So how do CIO increase revenue? And what is that solutions that you have provided?
Fine. So if you look at, increasing the revenues, one of the case study which I spoke of 2013, so that one, the M2M sensors always ensure that your vending machines are always full, okay? Which means if there's a vending machine at the airport or at the train station or on the street, if the vending machine is empty, there's no way people can buy it. Same way for Pepsi, what we extended this, and what we do is each of these vesiculars, the refrigerators, okay, which were run in a pilot phase, but each of these vesiculars and refrigerators, we had these sensors which will actually detect if the vending machine is full or not full, and if my vending machine is storing Pepsi or vending machine is storing some other cola brand or milk or curd, for example. Because while the vesicula is from Pepsi, if the shopkeeper is using it to store flavored milk, which we actually do see a lot of those examples, Pepsi is not getting benefited. So that's another way on how you can improve the revenue. How you could improve the revenue here? I will possibly just extend on how if it was me as a CEO there, how could I have done it? I would have said, if you buy a monthly pass, I give you free Wi-Fi service. If you buy a daily pass, I don't give you a free Wi-Fi service. So people will be bound to buy a monthly pass, and hence their behavior will start to change from using an auto or a bus to using this, because I've already bought a monthly pass. And that is what a number of Western countries do. They force you to buy a monthly pass by giving you a freebie, and then you start using it and the behavior will change.
Nitin, I'm Sandeep. Thank you for the wonderful session you just presented. I have a question more about microfinance and microinsurance.
Sure.
It is one of the nature which is in traditionally in Indian customers, they want to see the receipt of the payment, and whenever you're going for the micro insurance in the small locations or the remote places, so how that change is being transformed, how that change is being driven in your case studies.
Okay.
And second is in the same line, microfinance you just mentioned, but is there any solutions being done in the micro insurance sector also?
Okay. So we have not so far done the printing of receipts, but I do know of, I do know those micro printers which you can actually attach to your mobile phones. The mobile phones have to be smartphones in that case, and you can print out the receipts. So I've seen those, but no, I mean, this solution did not include the receipt. So this solution was not for the end subscriber. This solution was for the agents who were collecting the cash. So anyway, the agent is actually giving the receipt. But the problem was agent collects the cash, it does not deposit into their branches the same evening. Rather, or does not deposit 100% the same evening, rather deposit after a week. And if every day he does it, he is running his own parallel cycle of money and making money out of money which does not belong to him. So this was to save debt money for the company. But yes, I've seen those micro printers, the small ones. I've seen those credit card readers or the card readers which you can just fix on. So I've seen at least for Android and iOS, I've seen where you can just fix, they are just this much device and actually it also prints it out. Because you know, if you're using a thermal printer, you don't really need power. The USB power of phone is good enough to do the printout.
Yeah, Nitin, in one of the slides you talked about.
Sorry, Yes. So they have those, but like we don't very often sell devices itself. So we know those devices are available, but you know, as a communication company, what we are doing is we are enabling those, and yeah, we can refer the device manufacturers to yourselves, and you can buy it from them. Right, there was a question there. Then I'll
one of the presentation you talked about integrating the internet portal with Vodafone VLT technology. My question is Vodafone VLT technology something very proprietary? And another question is, what are the kind of the internet portal can be integrated through the SOAP?
Sure.
Is that marketplace solution or e-commerce site, or what are those exactly?
So VLT, so our VLT is based on cell ID. Okay, so one has to be telco. So I'm not saying that it's only Vodafone which knows it, other telcos can also do it. But you can obtain location two ways. You can use use GPS, in which you don't even need a telco. You can do without a telco. But you still need somebody to transfer the data of GPS from mobile phone to a central location. Now GPS devices are costly because the GPS chipsets are costlier. Plus GPS will not work, let's say in this location here, because there's a roof on top of us. Okay. So what we use is cell-based triangulation, which basically means irrespective of, so as long as you are any location where you are able to catch the signal, be it basement, this will work. And as a telco, we actually always already know your location. So only thing we are doing is we are monetizing the location which we know and giving it to your employer or to your distributor or back to you. And because we already know the location, what we have done is that's a piece of software which we develop, where we said one can obtain the location information and apply business rules and so on, basis APIs. So you know what we developed was this complete API framework, and we also give a portal. So either you can use our portal, or you can use the APIs integrate with your portal rather than using our portal. It could be done either ways. Now we have seen some of our customers use API and integrate to their portals. We have seen other customers who don't, who are not very technology savvy, don't have their own portals. They prefer to use our portals directly, where we give them admin access.
So in that case, what are the kind of services are being exposed to those APIs? There will be specific set of services. Those web services will have different features.
Yeah. So if I look at it today, you can define what we call a geo envelope. So you can define the geographical areas in which a movement can happen. You can define the routes. So we use Google Map as a basis of this. Okay. So on the Google Map, you can define the route, which is also good for safety purpose. So if the van which drops your employees late in the evening, it is supposed to follow a certain route. If it deviates, it can send an alarm. But if it's stopping at a particular place for more than an X minute, where you can again put a business rule, then also it can send you an alarm. So I mean, basically it's a location information, then everything else what you're applying is a business rule on top of it.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, Nitin. Myself, Ramesh here. I have a question on your delivery model. When UID is engaging with banks to go for a next level banking experience, So they are engaging agents with devices. So mostly the general public only trust the government of India or the trusted partners of government of India. So how effectively the word of own can exist in the banking ecosystem?
So I don't have an example from India yet, because like I said, we have not rolled it out. I have an example from Africa. Safaricom, that's what Vodafone is known in Kenya. They transfer more money than all the banks in Kenya combined. And Zimbabwe, the same story. So again, both the places, urban areas, yes, there are a lot of banks. Okay, the issue is the rural areas. So even in India, it's not banks can't go in. Banks can go in, but it's a cost, because in a day from a village, they will do a transaction of, let's say, 10,000 rupees or even 1 lakh rupees. But the cost of running that branch for a day, including all the employee salaries and all, will be more than that money. So there, what we are saying is just reuse our network. We already have it. And so we are doing it. I know Airtel is doing it. There are other few companies which are doing it. Banks have also started. So again, the money is not held by us here. The money is held by ICICI Bank. So by law and rules, we are a telco. We are not a bank. The account, even the banking account in this case, actually gets opened with a ICICI Bank. It's like a no-frills account with the ICICI Bank. Money is not getting transferred between mobile phones. Money is getting transferred between two bank accounts of ICICI Bank. And in future with maybe any other bank. We have started with the ICICI Bank. Earlier we had done pilots with HDFC Bank and so on. So money is actually moving between two bank accounts. It's just that rather than somebody giving a check, he's actually sending an SMS and the money gets moved.
Rules?
Yeah, we have a corresponding banking license for this. Yeah. So I mean, so for M-Pesa, we are governed by RBI, by specific RBI regulations, and we are with all the audits and everything else that comes with RBI.
Does it allow from international?
Not yet. The rules don't allow.
Okay. Nitin, morning.
And one thing I forgot. So, and there's a limit here. Because this is under corresponding banking license, the wallet cannot have more than 50,000 rupees and the per day transfer cannot be more than 10,000 rupees. But I think that's good limit for most of the non-urban areas.
Nitin, morning. One small clarification. On the mobility front, I mean, when we talked about telco need to play an important in terms of connectivity and the network bandwidth. So what is the role on Vodafone from that perspective? Because still we are talking about 4G. Still, I mean, we don't have that kind of bandwidth, getting to the end user. So what's the call on that from Vodafone perspective?
So the question is about 4G?
Not on 4G. I mean, it's talking about, I mean, the connectivity overall, I mean, to support the mobility which is going to, I mean, rule the future world. So from that perspective, what is that?
There will be wide gaps which will always be there. And that's how we're also working with the government to, because when it comes to M2M, when it comes to M-Pesa, you know, the wide gaps are no good. That is where we are working with government to find a solution where for those wide gaps, can we do a kind of intra-circle roaming and so on. Maybe over a period of time, yes, I mean, the wide gaps will reduce further and further, but then it should still be commercially viable. Rather than four companies putting in infrastructure, one company puts and other use it, it's always beneficial.
Morning, Nitin.
I'm
Shrikant. I have a small question on the mobile device manager you talked about. What is the extent of device locking features can be done on that? Is it limited to the internal memory, external memory? What is the kind of management you do on using the device, mobile device?
Okay. So it is actually limited to the interface on the phone, so be it the internal memory of the phone or the SD card which goes in, because the writing of to SD card is anyway happening through the phone CPU. Right. So that's how it controls it. But yeah, if the phone is connected via USB to a laptop, then you cannot control the laptop. It is primarily the phone, because application resides on the phone.
It is applicable even when you're on roaming?
Yes. Yeah, this is operator neutral. So you actually, yeah. So in a way, they are, you know, you don't even need an operator. So we provide a hosted version of it, so you don't have to pay upfront. But you can always go and buy the software directly by paying an upfront amount from people like AirWatch and Mobile and so on. Only reason why you need a operator, any operator, but a operator is because you have to connect over the air to the device when you want to control it. You actually don't need a connection if you don't want to apply a policy or if you don't want to control it. So maybe you will connect to a phone, I think no more than maybe once or twice a year. The frequency of how many times will you change the policies. And you will definitely connect to it when the employer runs away.
And what kind of misuse reports, as you mentioned, alerts are identified? Any
basis business rules, you can have any kind of business rules.
Any kind of business rules?
Yes.
There's no limitation on that?
There's actually no limitation. I mean, it's just basis business rules. Okay. So the best example is whatever you can do with your laptop is what you can do there. Or whatever you can do with a batch server on BlackBerry, you can do that plus more, because a batch today doesn't allow you to do location-based feature locking. I mean, yeah, you can develop a proprietary software behind it to do it and so on, but it doesn't allow you by default.
Thank you.
Nathan, Shafiq here again. Actually, when we talked about, again, on question on the MDM, is it going to be a product or is it a solution-based, how we have placed it?
It's a service.
Okay.
Nothing gets installed in your premises, and you pay per month rather than any upfront capex. So you don't require hardware, you don't require
software.
So
when I compare, you always compare with BlackBerry's MDM. So BlackBerry also has given a free, if you have the BlackBerry, license, by default, you get that as a free product. Is it something like that?
But you don't get it. You don't get it if you for a non-BlackBerry device.
Yeah, but they are improvising on that. If you see recent announcement, they are also touching iOS and
So maybe let me just take a quick poll. How many people here have got BlackBerry devices? So yeah, about 10, 15%. You can control 15%. You cannot control just 85% with BES today.
Okay. So and another question on that same MDM is it going to be a platform, in the premise or a cloud model?
MDM is on the cloud.
On the cloud,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, it's purely a service, just like any mobility service, a service to you.
Okay.
You can integrate the portal with your portal if you want, but that's not necessary. You can continue using. So we give you portal, we kind of create a logical partitioning, give you a portal, give you admin access rights for that portal. You can, when new employees join in, you can automatically get them subscribed to it, get added to, the administrator can get added to them. You don't need to contact a Vodafone call center for each and every new employee addition or deletion.
One more question, Nitin. This MDM, which has been provided by Vodafone, is it integrated with the cloud solution from Microsoft and Google afterwards?
No, I mean, we haven't integrated it. Also, there's a reason, as a telco, we cannot sell both Microsoft and Google cloud services in India because their infrastructure is located outside the country. You can buy it. As a telco, we cannot sell it. Our license conditions don't allow it, or any of the telco's license conditions don't allow it.
Okay, just to continue on that, how the applications are going to be placed? Is it going to be in Google Play, like how the app stores, or MDM has a space where you can download the apps?
Okay, so you can actually, the Vodafone MDM is enabled by AirWatch. You can either download AirWatch app from the app stores, or you can, like an SMS, and SMS comes, and you can remotely, install it on over the air.
I'm asking about the apps itself.
Yeah.
The enterprise apps that we create. Are we going to host it in the MDM space, or is it going to be in the Play stores?
Okay. So your enterprise apps have got no relationship to MDM. You can continue doing it the way you are doing it today. So MDM does not restrict you from using enterprise apps in a certain way. You can continue using it the way you are using it. This becomes an additional app. Okay. We can possibly talk offline over a cup of tea and so on.
Yeah.
Sure.
Thank you, Nitin, for a wonderful talk. I'm sure you all enjoyed the things he's saying. I know lots of you have many questions, so Nitin will be around, so please catch up with him. He'll be happy to.